Hey, you guys. How's it going? I'm Roger. This is Finn. This is Elijah. This is DJ. We're Killer Dale. And we're coming out with an album this Friday that we worked really hard on. And all you have to do to hear it is go to killerdale.com. And it's worth it. We worked really hard on it. I promise. There's going to be a show, too, but we can't talk about that form announcement rules. It's not on Friday, and it's not on Broadway and Spruce.
No, it's not at 1932 Broadway.
It's not. But yeah, that's all.
That's just totally not that rock and roll if you clean it up that fast. I'm sorry.
Hey, I'm Brayden, and this is Aaron. And we're both working on Fool's Fest this year, which is called Fool's Fest Loyola Fair now. Family Fair, thank you. And so it's a full-day event on March 25th with music and games and all that good stuff.
If you want to be involved, there's weekly meetings, and there's going to be a sign-up sheet in the front after forum. You can be involved in like a bunch of different aspects. We're still booking it, doing sponsorship, marketing, etc. So if that's something that interests you, you could email foolsfestloino@gmail.com or sign up or talk to us. Yeah, cool. Yeah,
and again, it's on March 25th from 12 to 7:30.
What's up, guys? My name's Kendrick. I released an EP under the It's not a misnomer. It's like a stage name. Yeah, whatever someone else just said is right. It's Kendobi. So yeah, I released an EP on Christmas, and the date was kind of arbitrary. So don't get caught up with that. And I'm gonna have my stems up on Outro next Monday. So yeah, hopefully you guys can use those and. Yeah, steal my work. It's cool.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alexis Martin.
And I'm John Scott.
And we're going to release a song today at 8 o'clock. Yeah, you can clap. Go. We're going to have a release party for it at the same time that we are releasing it. Come find me if you want to be there. Or find Alexis. I'm at John Scott Music on Instagram. And you are?
Alexis period Martin.
Beautiful. Have a great one, everyone.
Yo, what's good, y'all? Sam Wise here. Yo, I have a new edition. You know what I'm saying? Same edition, actually. New shipment of Dola Wines. They got the filter tips, rice papers. Damn, the sound stopped. I need more sound. Y'all aren't doing anything. Oh, okay, that was impressive. All right, on a more serious tip, we all know what just happened on Friday, and we all know what happened on Saturday to resist what happened on Friday, and that doesn't stop with, like, it already having happened, you know what I'm saying? So, like, tomorrow and in the following weeks, we're going to be... Well, me and a group of people are going to be out in front of the Dana Center with postcards and pens. So you can draw and write a note to your senator, your personal senator, not Louisiana. It's got to be your permanent address. And I highly suggest all of you do this because, first of all, that's how actual shit gets done in the government, is the senator and not the president, even though he's got executive orders and all that, you know, when I say nonsense. But yes, tomorrow, Dana Center... You can also do this on your own. You don't really need any help. You can just write a letter and send it to your senator. I highly suggest all of you do that. Thank you.
Ira! How you doing? Yo, it's a blessing and a privilege to look upon y'all faces again. I don't go to this school, but I still have some important information for y'all. Irie, as I just said before, is still here, you know what I'm saying? And we hitting 2017 real hard. As you can see, I got on some merch that is soon going to be going up for sale. It has the Irie logo on the back. I don't know if y'all could, you know what I'm saying? So, also, my band is under construction right now. I need a new drummer and a new electric guitarist. If you're interested, please get in contact with me. I'm going to be holding some kind of audition slash like jam session. But yeah, if you're interested, get in contact with me on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter while I'm here. You know what I'm saying? It was great seeing y'all. Bless.
As a faculty member, I'm totally going to cheat and make a gig announcement. After Timmy.
So February 1st, I'm having a show at Gasa Gasa. And it's 18 plus, so all you youngins can still come through. Gasa Gasa is 18 plus now. February 1st, 9 o'clock, thank you.
I promise I didn't set that up on purpose. Thursday night in Roussel Hall at 7:30, Matt Wright, the trombone professor here, is doing a recital, and he's doing a piece that I wrote for trombone and computer. So those of you who are into like weird computer sounds and trombones and stuff, you should totally come hang out. It's about an hour long and it'll be trippy, and I'll be there. Thank you. 7:30 Roussel Hall, Thursday night.
All right. For those of you that are interested in law, legal issues, I've been asked to start up a new EU that will deal with those sorts of things. The primary task of which we will perform will be PRO registrations, copyright registrations, and basic analysis of legal agreements. So it'll all be under my direction, but I'm hoping that it will be student-driven so that you all who want to get some practice at entertainment law or music law will have an opportunity to do that. So if that's something you're interested in, come find me in my office or shoot me an email, and we'll get started right away. All right, thank you.
Hey. Hi. Okay, two things. One, the spots for France are filling up quickly. There are two opportunities to go to France, the first of which is if you want to go for 4 weeks. The second of which is if you just want to go to Madame. The class goes to Paris, then we take a 3-day excursion down to the shores, the lovely, luxurious shores of France, and we go to Midème on June 6th. If you are just interested or only able to go to the Midème conference, then that happens at the top of June, like I said, June 6th, and you need to speak with me directly about that. For more information about the class, you can head to the Study Abroad website and just look up Paris Summer Class. And for more information about Midème conference, where you get tons of opportunities to interface with pros, please contact me directly via email. Those spots are filling up very, very quickly. The second thing is we have a performance opportunity for anybody interested. Congratulations to those who performed at the Neutral Ground over the weekend, first of all. And coming up, I think Mr. Panacori did. Coming up this week, we have our first installment of the Spring Satchmos. So if you are interested in performing Thursday evening, that kicks off at 7 and we'll go till question mark. So it's a cool party, all right? So email me directly if you want to perform that night. This is this coming Thursday, the 26th. Otherwise, have a good forum.
All right. Just one more real quick thing before we get on to our guest today. As you know, it's another semester, and that means it's another semester of Intro to Music Industry group projects. And a lot of you have already emailed me to volunteer your services as artists for group projects, and I've passed those emails along to all the project groups. However, I do believe that one or two of the project groups might still be looking for one or two artists. So if anyone in this room is interested in doing this, and I know most of you have already been through the semester project already as a participant. If you'd like to do it as an artist, email me tonight, either like right now or in the next couple hours after forum, and then I'll get those straight to the project groups, and you may or may not hear from them. All right, lfaber@loyno.edu. And to introduce our guest today, Libby.
Hey guys, I'm Libby Donnelly. I graduated here last year, and after graduation, I started working for a great company called Outro, and they're your speakers tonight. We're a music production platform, and Mark and Connor, they're here when they get on stage. You guys wanna... So this is Connor, this is Mark.
Hey. What's up?
They're gonna be going. They're gonna be telling you about our platform, about how they started it, and if we get internet, maybe a little demo of it. So here you guys go.
Cool. Hey guys, I'm Mark. This is Connor. Like Libby beautifully introduced, we're here to talk about our platform. We're here from Montreal. I don't know if you mentioned that. I wasn't really listening. it's an incredible honor to be here. We don't do this ever. We've never presented the platform to more than like four investors, really. So like speaking is not really our thing. So just go easy on if we fuck up or things don't go so well. Cool. I'll hit the next slide.
Yeah.
Go back for a second. We'll talk about this quote. We just wanted something cool to have on the screen for you guys to read, but there's a little backstory to this. It's not a real word. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this word. It's from this. All right, don't stand there. It's from like a fake dictionary that this guy who like creates words to explain kind of like notions and things that don't have a word, and it was sort of the realization that led to the platform. And I thought it was kind of fitting today because there's so many people in this room. Like Libby's told us a lot about you guys, and we've met quite a few of you. There's just so many different backgrounds. You guys are into all kinds of things, and one of the realizations that led to the platform is just thinking about a room full of people exactly like this, with so many incredible talents, and what would be the result of a platform that allowed just limitless collaboration, where everybody could contribute like just exactly what they're best at, and look to other people to kind of complete their skill set, and that's one of the things that got the wheels going. So I thought it'd be cool to have on screen. So why are we here? Let's start with why you guys are here, because I think that speaks volumes. You guys are here, you're pursuing careers that I think everybody in this room is passionate about. You guys are going to school, and I think that speaks volumes. It says that you're serious about what you're doing and you want to pursue new technologies, and the fact that you're sitting in this room, I don't know if it's mandatory. Yes? No?
Yes.
It's mandatory.
Never mind. Right. We're happy you're here.
Thanks for not being sick today. A question we often get asked is, like, what's the future of the music industry? Like, there's some secret answer to that, I think ultimately it's the wrong question. Like, it's who. You guys are the future of the music industry. No matter what happens, no matter what advancements in music technology over the next 5-10 years, it's always gonna be about artists, like the great storytellers. You guys take thoughts and emotion and turn it into lyrics and melodies and just convey that to millions of people across the world. It's unbelievable. Same for musicians. You guys add the flavor and the texture to music that, you know, that carries this message forward, and producers, the translators, as Connor likes to put it, the guys that kind of tie it all together. Engineers, lyricists, writers, managers, like this is what it's all about. From our perspective, any advancements in music technology should be about supporting and facilitating and connecting you guys more and not replacing you. So that's one of the big values that kind of drives the development of our platform, it's gonna shape all of our decisions for the next few years. The end. Yeah, we're gonna start with, that's it. Yeah, you guys are out. we're gonna start with like a little visualization exercise. We'll show you a few months from now what it could look like for sort of the ideal creator on the platform. We'll give you a view of like a dashboard and visualization. It's a big thing that we do as a company.
It's from Jim Carrey.
Yeah, it is. It is from this Jim Carrey interview where he talks about like how he used to drive up to Runyon Canyon, I think, and just visualize like this $10 million check and like being in the industry, and it's something that's kind of allowed us to get to where we're at. And I think it's true for musicians, for any art form, for any business, to make something new, to do something that's never been done before, you have to first visualize, you have to imagine it, and then find a path to get there. So that's what we're gonna do.
Hopefully
Well, I don't think we're going to make as big as an impact as the exploding guitar, but we'll try. So what is Outro? Really what we are is a music production platform, like Libby said. It's a two-sided marketplace. Mark hates it whenever we say Airbnb or Etsy of music, but really it's a two-sided marketplace. So the idea is connecting musicians and creators, guitar players, drummers, literally everybody in this room, connecting you guys with the right people to work with across the world. Get rid of geographical limitations and work literally using the best of technology from today. Today, musicians do so many things. You play gigs, you're in like seven bands sometimes, you're doing like sync licensing opportunities, you're playing wedding gigs to help make cash, you're doing so many things. So for us, it's the way we envision this platform and this beautiful place where people can, grow is really required to be a two-sided platform, meaning a place where you can give and take. So on one side of the platform, the idea is you can really come to this beautiful place, this online platform, with a song that you're working on, or looking for inspiration, and you can look through a catalog of sounds from made by people literally all over the world. So you can either find these sounds, or you can actually directly connect with the people that made them. So it's really about making those connections and finding the right people to collaborate on your project. Now, what's exciting for you guys is the other side of the platform, which is really what you guys are about. Since you guys are really at the cusp of your careers, about to graduate, about to go out and find ways to, build a financial career and a real future in the music industry, is the creator side. So we have a supply and demand, two sides on the platform. And the supply side is really just amazing talent, which is why we're so excited to speak to you guys today, because that's what this is about. So on the platform, you as a creator can both sell sounds, loops, beats, whatever you create as a producer or musician, but you can also make your services available to people so that you can offer your services as a session player. So really, this is the ultimate vision, and what we're gonna do is visualize. We kind of did some recon, and Libby helped us choose some random people in the crowd. Maybe I think one of the Dylans isn't here that we're gonna pick on, anyways, we're just gonna picture your life in 4 months from now, working on Outro. So we're starting with the end. So these three guys, Dylan Kidd, Rishav, hopefully I'm saying that right, and Dylan Seals. Let's dive into their world in Outro right now.
Are they here? You guys here? Anybody?
Dylan Kidd graduated. Rishav is in jazz studies.
Oh, Rishav isn't around.
We were misinformed.
No worries. We're gonna work with Rishav. It's all good. So who's somebody we can pick on? Is there anybody you guys think we should use to continue instead of Rishav? Yeah, right there. Joe Cow. Cool. So anywhere you see Rishav, it's Joe Cow now. Okay, cool. So welcome to Outro. This is you, May 2017. So this is the platform where you come. We kind of created a fake story. Let's say you're a drummer. I don't know. What do you do?
Yeah.
You're a drummer. Amazing. That worked out great.
I do now. You saw that $4,500. He's like, all right. So
let's say you played a gig at Tipitina's last night. Went really well. You have another gig with that performer tonight. So the gig got canceled. Soundcheck got canceled. But also, like, your paycheck for tonight got canceled, right? So you were planning on making, some money tonight. So the idea is you can come to Outro and still work on your career as a musician. So here's the dashboard. You can see really just an overview of your life and your career in music on the platform. So let's dive in a little deeper. So we can offer you analytics and all kinds of sales on how you're doing on the platform. How much money have you made this month? How much money have you made this week working and collaborating with people across the globe. So you made, $4,500 so far this month. The next payout's gonna be $390. You get great analytics on, what days of the week are you doing the best collaborations? Maybe you're not doing so well on Wednesdays because you have, classes or, some kind of other gigs. So that's totally cool. So all of these tools can be used for informing you to be, a better creator on the platform. So seeing as there's two things you can do on the platform, you can both collaborate with people as well as sell your content. You can check in on your collaboration, see how everything's going with people. So here, we just made up some artists that these are a couple people we're working up with in Canada and kind of northern states and stuff. So here's Nova. She's a girl that you're working with directly. So on the platform, there's both direct and public requests. So you can connect with somebody directly and say, hey, I really love what you do. I want you to drum on my track. Here's my track. I have a $150 budget. Can you take that into a studio and work on that with me? The great part is that there's also a public request board. So if people have trouble finding the perfect person to work with, they can just post the job to the full community. So you, as a creator, can then just go hit that public request board and see, this one looks really great for me. I'm gonna, fill out these couple requests and then make money as a creator. That's ultimately the vision of the whole platform. It's helping people make money doing what they love. So what's also great is you have catalog sales as well. So let's say you have instrumentals, or if you're a drummer, you booked a really great studio and you tracked a bunch of loops and stems for people to work on, you can have those selling passively as well. So you can generate passive revenue. So you can just check in on how much money you made while you were sleeping. So now you have the day free. So you can check out a really cool curated list of daily opportunities on the platform. So check out the public request board. What kind of stuff is available for me right now? What kind of requests are there that really suit my skills, my talents, and how much money can I make today literally doing what I love? So that's really the vision of what this dashboard is trying to do.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, so you guys have you've seen where we're headed, and that's like we said, an ideal kind of situation for a creator on the platform in a few months. Now, we thought it'd be a really good idea to kind of tell you our story and just tell you what puts us in a position to make some of these claims. It's maybe stuff that you've heard before, and we'd love to just take a few minutes to go through our personal stories. So 3 years ago, I've been a musician my whole life. I've been an artist since I was like 6 years old. But 3 years ago, things were not going well. I was working in a warehouse in Toronto, and my job was to wrap these giant TVs in saran wrap or cling wrap, I don't know what you guys call it, to protect it before it was shipped out. So that was my day for 10 hours a day. And it was not fun. It was not what I wanted to be doing with my life. And so a year before that, if I back it up a little bit, I set out to make an album, and I wanted to make the whole thing by myself. I wanted to record it by myself. I wanted to produce it by myself. And for some reason, I just had this, I guess it stemmed from my lack of confidence as an artist. I didn't really believe that I could do this. I could merge my dreams with reality and do that in such a way that I'd be able to support myself and support a family. So I kind of had this lack of confidence going into it, and that I didn't have the courage to reach out and reach out to people like Connor and producers and musicians that I should have been collaborating with, and different writers to kind of see my idea through to its completion. And that was a huge flaw in my thinking. And there's one exception. I wanted a live drummer on the album, and I don't play drums. So I have too much respect for the craft to try to pick it up and do that. So I went to the only studio I could afford, which was this guy's place, 100 feet down the street from my place. And he had a studio in his mom's basement. And we worked with this drummer called Chris LaMarsh, who actually filled out the first request on Outro a few months ago. So that was kind of a cool full circle moment. But yeah, it was a great session. We did a 10-hour session and did all the drums for the album. And within the first few minutes, I was like, man, I've been thinking about this all wrong. It was too late to back it up and redo the album. But I realized the flaws in my thinking as an artist and just wanted to control the whole process and do the whole thing. And maybe a little bit of ego and not wanting to reach out to other people to add to it. So anyways, I went back to Toronto, back to the warehouse. I didn't have confidence in the final product, so I didn't really push it out. And I just hit this point where I was like, something needs to change. And I started looking kind of beyond my walls, and I realized that my calling isn't to tell my story. I think the reason I'm here is to help other people tell their story. There's so many more talented artists and more talented producers and musicians that just are struggling to make ends meet and struggling to make things click. And I think that's a much more natural place for me to sit. So I started thinking about a platform, and I started thinking about how there's all this crazy, insane talent all over the world, and there's different styles that are separated geographically, and it's hard to really find the right people to work with. And I just started thinking, what would a platform look like? So that's what we set out to build. I went to Connor a few months later, and I was just looking for the perfect collaborator, someone with the technical background that I didn't have, and someone who's more of a go-getter than I am. I'm a planner. I'm a like presentation maker. Connor's like the giver. So yeah, I went to him, and I'm glad I did.
Yeah, so my story up until then, I guess I'm a music producer as well. I'm sure there's so many of us in the room. My story is, I guess, kind of like a classic production route. I don't know, it starts with just messing around with Audacity when you're like 11, 12. I'm sure literally everybody here has done that. And then you're just working with a friend, and then all of a sudden he's showing other friends, and then all of a sudden somebody says, hey man, how much do you charge for, you know, working on my music? And all of a sudden, like by age 15, 16, I found myself, I don't know, working as, a, I don't know, production, studio work, and just kind of fell into it by passion and just loved it so much and just, you know, did the 100-hour work weeks and just going nuts, you know? So Quebec, has anybody ever been to Quebec? To Montreal? How'd you guys like it? Yeah, it was cool? Yeah, I love Montreal. I'm such a big fan. Yeah, anyways, Quebec is weird. Like, the industry is really its own kind of universe. There's its own full industry that really doesn't look outside of Quebec. Like, the music that's popular right now in Quebec is kind of 10 years old. It's like old pop rock, kind of 90s stuff. But it's still a thriving scene, but I guess I just didn't relate to it. And I was just doing a lot of sessions, working with a lot of people, and kind of had the same epiphany Mark did, and just, you know, I was working with like a retro soul kind of, you know, early 60s style Motown label, and just like working with real horn players the first time and just really freaking out about that, and just realizing the importance of really working with the right people. So I just started calling around, and I started working in studios kind of all over the place in Montreal, and then I came down to a studio, close to here, in El Paso, Texas, called Sonic Ranch. Have you guys ever heard of that place? Yeah? Cool. Anyways, beautiful studio. It's like a five. And so I went there a couple times just to work and learn, because I felt like I connected with the guys down there and the music down there so much more. And coming back, you know, just, you know, took that and started to apply it to the Quebec scene, and thinking, you know, if I live here, you got to be a part of the industry. And you know, I learned to fall in love with it, despite it maybe not being my closest music passion. But yeah, doing the session with Mark was really great, because I could relate to him as an artist on such a great level. And we were really like the perfect, you know, kind of compatible, you know, partners for this kind of a project, as well as, you know, for literally what we're talking about, this two-sided marketplace. Mark was literally the kind of artist who needed the person to help them with their project and connect them with the right opportunities and with the right, you know, musicians to work on their project. And I was the person who was, at least in Montreal, in our local area, able to help him through some of the first few struggles, which was really cool. So really, we kind of represented the two sides of Outro that we're trying to build, me being the creator side and Mark really being on the consumer side, or the, you know, the kind of artist side. So yeah, that's where we started, and we've learned a lot of lessons since. It's been crazy, you know. We were both just music dudes, and trying to build a business is a pretty radical thing, and just a lot of lessons, a lot of failure, a lot of mistakes, a lot of learning, and a big lesson there is really just, you know, about working with the right people again. But Mark has, you know, some great things that we kind of struggled through.
Are there any, like, you said there's entrepreneurship as well as part of the curriculum here. So is anybody like thinking about starting a company one day? Cool. Oh, that's rad. Nice. Well, good luck.
Not in that
I say
way.
That with so much love. My favorite quote about entrepreneurship or starting a business is by Elon Musk. You guys have probably heard of him. He said that starting a business is like staring into the abyss and chewing on glass. And that's the end of the quote. So. That's it. That's pretty accurate. I think we definitely felt that. But it's been really, really good lessons along the way. The first version of the platform was targeted specifically to my situation. It was for artists. It was a DAW built fully within the browser that was, we attempted to simplify it to the point that someone with no production experience could sit down in front of their computer and go from having an idea to a finished song. And we got to what we thought was a really solid product, and then we launched it out, and we realized that there was a lot of flaws in our thinking. Whenever you're making something, you hear this word disruptive thrown around a lot, and it's definitely like, it's important to have a disruptive business model, it's important to have disruptive marketing and things that really like cut the grain on a lot of things, but you don't want a disruptive product. You want your product to be as seamlessly integrated into people's lives as possible, and that was the problem with the first one. It was too much, we were expecting too much of the artist, We're expecting them to have a skill set that they don't have, the ability to like arrange different parts and like layer things. And the supply side was very similar. It was still producers and musicians supplying all the content that they were making songs with, but to expect them to be able to sit down and go from zero to 100 was just too much. So that led to the second version of the product, which is kind of half of what Outro is. And that was just this idea of like a workspace where you could pull like things together and you could interact with content and kind of download stems and loops. So we gave you a cool way to do that. There were a few problems there. Mostly we underestimated like the power of collaboration, which is the second half of Outro that I think makes it so strong. It's the fact that like you can see someone's catalog and not just pick out like content, but actually talk to them and collaborate with them and work on them and build a relationship and kind of set up your network within the platform and use that as a way to like, you know, see your project through to completion. So if there's like one lesson that we learned, it's just like listen to people that are using your stuff. Listen to them because they have all the answers. Talk to them every opportunity you get. Every feedback, piece of feedback has to be turned into an improvement on the platform, and that's got us to where we are now. Anything you want to add there, lessons?
Lessons, some crazy stuff. I don't know. You know, I think one big one is just, I don't know, like, I went through, like, you know, just, like, studying jazz guitar when I was younger, too, and sometimes, obviously, you have to put in the hours, right? You got to put in, like, the 8-hour days, and then the 12-hour days, and then the 16-hour days when you're, like, doing a studio session at the end of the night. But sometimes, like, you really have to learn to take a break and learn to, like, take care of yourselves. And I felt that was something we did a lot. It was, like, a lot of go. It was, like, working literally 8 days a week, you know? Like, just going nuts. And once we still don't do it well enough, but, you know, like, we try to take time to every now and then just look around. Like, we took the last 2 days just, like, exploring NOLA and, like, loving it. And it's the first 2 days we've taken off. And, Christmas, we took a day off. And, like, other than that, it's, like, for you, it's 3 years. For me, like, it's a long time, too. So, I don't know, just, yeah, perspective, breaks, and especially, like, when you're in studio, too, that's the biggest thing. You know, just take the 15 minutes when you need to every 2 hours and you know, do a tour of the block, whatever, you know, go get a drink or something. That's just what we learned from, like, kind of going full force for so long.
Cool. Absolutely. So, yeah, now let's take a look at, like, the consumer side of the platform. Where people are going to be buying all your stuff. The whole idea here is, like, there's a lot of kind of, like, parts of the solution out there. We know the idea of, like, a loop library is nothing. It's nothing novel. It's a lot of just combining, like, different elements that already exist that makes Outro special. But one of the sort of problems that I had as an artist is the idea of, like, inspiration, but, like, functional inspiration. So, like, I was very inspired as a creator. I had, like, maybe too many ideas, but there were moments where, like, I didn't know what to do, and I had to move forward. So I just did something, and that was, you know, what pushed the project forward, and often that's not the right answer. So the idea with Outro is, like, whether you're starting your song and you're just looking for, like, the first piece of content to get you started, the perfect progression, like, the perfect baseline to just kind of kick things off, or for probably most of the scenarios, like, you're already making something. Maybe you already have, like, the beat and the baseline, you just want to add something to it. We wanted to support that kind of, like, those different contexts, and there's no way for us to predict them, so we needed to make a software that kind of allows us to, no matter what stage of the creative process you're in, you can sit down on Outro and, like, find stuff that's going to help you fill holes. So you can see here, I don't know how well you can see. Oh, pretty well. Okay, cool. So that's, yeah, you'll see the left panel there. This is, like, the broad ways that we kind of categorize content. One of the things that we tried to do was make it a little bit less dry than, like, because, you know, there's going to be millions of pieces of content with it by the end of the year. So we were like, okay, how can we make that actually fun to go through? So we started thinking about, like, how music is consumed and all these amazing companies like 8-Tracks and Songza and Spotify. And it's, like, it's really, like, these curated lists of, like, vibes and moods and things like that. So we started grouping content like that and having our producers kind of produce into different contexts like that. And then we expose that on the front end to consumers as well. So as a creator, like, when you upload your stuff, you say, this is, like, yeah, it's like a rainy, like, kind of sad, like, melancholy, like, piece of music, and then someone who's searching for exactly that is going to find your stuff. So we give as many, like, touch points between people who are uploading content and people who are going to download content as we can. And yeah, another big thing that we focused on was, like, presenting content. So it's not just, like, pieces of audio on the screen. Everything's kind of, like, well designed, and we work with all of our creators. We hook them up with photographers and designers so that they can make these really cool packs and, like, give, like, sort of a visual presentation to the content that I think is going to make it a lot more attractive to people who are looking for it. So we call it the intelligent catalog, and there's a few things that kind of contribute to that definition. You'll notice on the right of each piece of audio, there's like a drop-down menu, that black thing at the end of the green. So all of our creators, like for most of the content, it's recorded in different keys and different tempos, because it is like contextual. We want people to be able to like add the content to their song. Well, if you're making something already, then you're locked into a certain key and you're locked into a certain tempo. So if we have 1 million stems that are only available at one key and one tempo each, it's a pretty small library when you really break it down. But as soon as you have stuff that's recorded in every key and a few different tempos, and then we start time stretching to meet the tempos in between, things like very quickly get multiplied. And you'll notice there's sort of a division in the screen below that transport there. It says, working on a song, upload it here to find sounds that complete your music. So this is kind of like the secret sauce behind the platform. If you're working on something, you bounce it down quickly, throw it into that little space down there, and then we analyze it and run some crazy algorithms to try to see what kind of sounds, so what kind of loops and what kind of samples are going to be compatible with what you're making. So it's a really just like a seamless experience. That's what we wanted to create, is just this, like you sit down and it's effortless to use the platform. It doesn't feel like you're browsing through like a library of a million sounds. It feels like it's just kind of reading your mind and like feeding you stuff the same way that a producer would feed you stuff. That's what we're trying to build, is like this seamless, effortless experience. There's that word, seamless collaboration. So this is like someone's producer card you can see there on the phone. Think of it as like a business card. So you have like your featured content on there. You can pick three pieces of audio, three songs, or like three things that you've worked on, just to kind of showcase your skills, show people what your style is. We have chat on there as well, so people can strike up conversations and you can discuss like, okay, what's your budget for the project? What's your time frame? Is this even gonna work? And then once you kind of come to an agreement, then you click collaborate there and it takes you into the collaboration window where things are a little more official. And the person making the requesting the collaboration goes through like a series of steps that we've built after like years of talking to musicians who work remotely already. And we've just tried to see, okay, what are like the main things that people often leave out when they're asking for something. And it's like, you'd be surprised, like someone just sends a guy, like a bass player in England, and they're like, yeah, I need some bass, like I have $100. And that's kind of the end of the conversation. The guy has to work with that. So we try to make it a little bit more of a process. So we say, okay, what's your song? You upload your song, and then you say, where do you want it to go? What key, like, you know, like what kind of register do you want it in? And just ask all these different questions that help people kind of get through the process. Once you come to an agreement, send a few revisions back and forth, the person's happy with it, and then all payments happen through the platform as well. So as a creator, like you just upload your stuff, or you successfully work on a collaboration, and you're paid directly to your bank account.
The key there is like Mark was saying before, it's just, we've literally been talking to musicians, producers, creators, like from a lot from NOLA now through Libby, obviously a lot in Canada, but now we have people joining from Germany and literally all over the world. So it's just, we're constantly talking to people, and that's part of what we want to talk about with you guys today too, is we're trying to build something, and there's like no ego here, right? It's all about like, it's kind of like the people's platform, really. It's a platform to help the music industry grow and to help everybody find opportunities. So it's so key for, you know, if you guys start using the platform, you get involved, tell us what sucks. Tell us what's cool, and just, you know, open communication. And everything that you're seeing now is based on conversations we've had with people and learning we've done up until now. So we need to keep that going, and everybody works differently. So, we're stoked to hear what you guys think and you know, see how everybody uses it. So we were going to do a demo, but I think the internet's acting a little weird. So we thought we'd tell you kind of, we launched the platform officially November 1st, and it's been awesome working with music creators, producers, musicians. It's been so easy, but it's been great getting everybody on board because they see the value, they see the opportunity to be able to brand themselves somewhere, to be able to make money, and literally just like help advance their careers. And we have a couple thousand creators already now, like I said, from all over the world, some awesome people. But it's been really hard getting the word out because we're like a really small company. You know, we're like 8, 6, 7 people in Montreal, yeah. Libby out here. We're a small team. Our like marketing budget is like 4 minutes of like Apple's marketing budget, right, annually. So literally yeah. How can we get the word out and get people talking about it, get people using it? So we kind of came up with this slightly naive and obnoxious campaign. And it's called Outro Million. So over the month of February, what we're going to be doing is working with musicians literally everywhere. We're recording a million sounds. These are like loops, samples, Foley stuff, musicians, instrumentals, all kinds of stuff over the month of February. And then we're giving everything away for free from March 1st to April 1st. So this kind of massive campaign to raise awareness and just to get people involved. So it's going to be this like really exciting campaign, basically like an advent calendar month where literally every day in February we have a really cool creator highlight video, you know, talking about NOLA musicians and talking about street musicians that we met, you know, here and in Montreal and really all over the place. We're going into all these crazy locations. We're going to like a fire station and a zoo and literally just crazy stuff. So it's going to be really exciting. And yeah, the idea is we have a couple tricks in being able to make the million happen. But really what we need is people to get involved and you guys to get involved, which is part of, you know, why we're here today. You know, we're trying to bring people on Outro to build long-term careers. And this campaign is really just a spark to get that started and to make it happen. So what we really want is, you know, to work with you guys, to set you guys up with local studios that you can work at and, you know, build up your catalog and your sounds and make yourself available as you know, creators. Who here has like a home setup or like a home studio that you guys can work out of?
Sick.
Wow, a lot of people. Cool. If not, you guys all have access to the studios at school or like local studios. I'm sure you guys all have like buddies that are doing great work too, right? Cool. So yeah, the campaign is crazy and we're so excited to talk about it, to get people involved, and we're so excited to highlight a lot of the NOLA guys and girls in the campaign. Part of what we're trying to do as well is rather than just linking people with people, is really build communities online. So that's why it's great to speak at Loyola too, because it's important for, you know, people to be successful on Outro and for things to work, for people to you know, work amongst their own communities on the platform. Have you guys all heard like Bruno Mars 24K, right? Literally every bassist in here was like, yo, that's the dopest synth bass track. But also kind of said, I feel like I could have come up with it if I was in the room, if I had like a Minotaur or like something cool. You know, I know when it came out, like three bassist buddies were like, man, I got to learn this at like for every wedding gig next summer. And like everybody was saying that. But what we really want to do is like there's so much talent literally in this room amongst you guys. It's just about helping that lock into the right opportunities and getting the right writing sessions and the right production sessions and working with the right people. So That's ultimately what Outro is about, and we want to get you guys involved. So what we actually have, I don't know if we'll be able to link it up just because of the internet, but on the site, we have like a Loyola exclusive kind of organization page where you guys can all be set up. You can see who else is on the platform from the school, and you guys can collaborate and work together right there. So we'll link that to you guys afterwards through email, I guess, since we won't be able to open it up right now. But it's basically outro.io/organization/Loyola University. So it's pretty straightforward.
And if anybody has any questions, just come to Libby. She's got all the information for you guys.
Yeah.
Cool. That do it?
Yeah.
Sick.
I'm so sorry about the Willow thing, honestly. I'm so sorry if I offended somebody about the Willow thing. I've literally never been there, so. I was just like, is there any bar, you know? Anyways, I'm sorry.
Yeah, just before we wrap it up, I just wanted to show you guys our incredible team, because they couldn't be here today. That's Alex Vados on the top left there. He's our lead developer. Everybody looks super young, I'm realizing now. He's just incredible. He's like the glue that holds it all together. You'll see all the business people in here, like you'll see the most important thing that you guys do. I'm sure you've heard it a million times, but it's like passion and team. Just finding the right team, finding the right people to bring on board. Just they'll grow into the roles. They'll learn the skills that they have to. Just make sure that they're a good fit and they believe in what you're doing. Libby's our face on the ground here, so she's putting the whole network together in New Orleans. She's working with studios down here to get you guys like discounted rates, and we'll sponsor some sessions as well, so you can just go in and record for free. So if you have any questions, just hit up Libby. If you want to know where she got that hat, I'm sure she's got the answer buried deep somewhere in the closet. Kevin's another dev. I'll breeze through this because I think we're running over. Kevin's like, we're okay?
Oh, yeah?
All right, cool. So Kevin's, he's like our youngest developer. He just started coding like 6 months ago. And he's like the perfect example of like, just hire the right people
and give them the resources they need to learn, and hook them up with like people who can share information with them, like Alex. And he's single. He told me to say that in the presentation. So yeah.
He's single. This guy.
He loosens the tie sometimes too.
Yeah. Yeah. He's the man. You wanna do the last three?
Yeah. Sure. I tend to always give people nicknames in the office. We got K-Dog. K-Dog. So he's also a dev guy. He's just like the coolest dude, makes the most awkward jokes, but we love him. And then we have DGD, who's kind of like our community, like our online community. We call him the community hacker. Basically, he's like talking to everybody on Reddit, on I'm sure you guys know Gear Sluts, and like just all these great forums online, constantly learning from people, talking to people. And then we just brought Paul on board, who's an international DJ known by Jay London. I don't think he's ever been out here, so you guys probably won't know him. Super like electronic stuff. He's like the only bro in the office, but we love him, and we love him for that. But yeah, Paul is great because he's hooking up all the sponsorships for the campaign, working with some great companies, you know, all our PR stuff, and kind of bringing some you know big name artists on board, literally from all over the world. A lot of electronic guys, a lot of producers. So he's been great for that, partners, sponsors, and stuff. So this is the team, and it's small, but you know it's growing so fast. You know,
we're feisty.
Six months ago, it was just you know the two of us, and now it's just growing every day, and it grows with everybody that joins the platform too. So that's yeah, this is us.
So that's it.
Are you guys here? Oh yeah. Yeah.
You guys are the shit. That's cool.
A couple questions? Do you have a question? Cool, go ahead.
That's a good question. Right now we're focused on like the other side of it, so like seeing what other APIs are exposed so we can tap into them. There's some really cool ones for, I forget who had it, but there's a giant kind of like network of artists that are connected to similar artists. It's from like a music listening service, so that's a really interesting thing that we're going to pursue in the next few months.
I asked that because like I had a similar idea for a platform that had like other information as well. And I think it'd just be really cool to like be able to include your database with other people, because like it's really hard to like start over with a new database. You know, you're always trying to get information from like Spotify and SoundCloud. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, that's a great idea. Yeah. We're not just collaboration like platform. We're a collaborative platform, so we try to work with other companies as much as we can. Like, yeah, especially in the music industry. Shoot.
What is the best way for someone to make money using your platform? And then also, how do you guys make the majority of your money?
Sure. Yeah, we can maybe tag team that one. The best way right now, since the community is still small and growing, is start by having. What do you do? Are you a musician, creator?
Oh, I'm the production manager at the Willow.
Okay. I'm so sorry. Libby!
That was a nice question. You asked the question.
I literally have never been there. I'm like... Okay, so the... Full circle. So the best thing for like musicians and producers to do is upload a badass catalog. Start there by having awesome loops, sounds, stems, instrumentals, all kinds of stuff. And now the public request board and just in general, the request system is literally picking up every day. We have this great guy who I'm sure you guys all know, Dominic Minix. He's getting involved in like constantly filling out like public requests. So we have some great people on the platform, some great talent. So if you're looking to collaborate with somebody, what you do is you say, hey, Joe Cow, right? Hey, Joe, I have like an $80 budget for a drum track. Here's my track. And Joe says, you know what, I can only do it for $100 because the studio is going to charge me $60 for 2 hours. You can just build a price together, and then you can pay him for his work.
So it's just like all one-on-one negotiations?
One-on-one, or in the public request board, there's you, if you're looking for content, you say, hey, drum world, drum community, I have $80. And multiple people can submit. It's kind of like 99 designs. You can pick the one that you think is the best suited for your project.
And then you all just
take 8%. We take 8%, which you know, the typical agency fee is like 15 to 20% kind of thing. So, yeah, we that's how we make money.
Yep.
Third question. How's the money regulated? guys a party that regulates transfer of money, or does money go from bank to bank from
we
person
use a,
to person? Because,
sorry.
Because, like, how would you ensure that you're getting paid? You could pay $80 for a drum track, and the person, you don't know them, they might never deliver it. Why is that more beneficial than just talking to someone on Facebook who's a drummer and saying that you know, and then having them transfer the money?
We use a payment processor called Stripe. We integrate that within the platform, so that allows us to kind of just have all of these complex like relationships between people, but we never actually have to handle sensitive data. So we never actually get credit card information or personal information or anything like that. It never touches our servers. So that's why we use Stripe, because it's just a really nice situation for that. And to answer your second question, like, that's something we have to contend with a lot, is like this idea of trust. You know, I'm going to do this work. It's like an $80 job. It's worth a few hours of my time, but not if this guy doesn't pay me, obviously. So we're going to be working over the next couple months to build a very like intricate rating system. So you'll know exactly who you're working with. You'll be able to see like who they've worked with. You'll be able to see comments and like, you know, what was the result of their previous five collaborations, and has anyone ever had a problem with them? So just trying to add a lot of transparency to the process. I think that's one of the strengths of the platform. You always kind of know. Exactly. Yeah. Very similar system. Yep.
So yeah, how did this person perform on the last couple requests that they worked on? Were they late on delivery? Did they end up just not filling it out? All these things that'll help you evaluate before. The way you do right now is you just talk to your buddy and say, "Hey man, have you ever worked with these guys? Like, is he good? Like, is he gonna like commit to my project?" So we can build that into the platform for you and help you answer those questions before you even reach out.
And there's going to be abuse. I mean, there's going to be situations where people don't get paid. And in that case, we step in as a platform and say, okay, you're looking to work with this drummer. Here's 10 that we know, like these are on our team, and these guys are going to give you like the quality you're looking for.
Yeah. You had a question?
Here's my question. What happens if you suck and you keep hitting the public like requests things, putting down awful tracks?
Yeah.
Well, you get better.
You get better, yeah. Yeah. Well, it's a public request form. I mean, it's kind of like, it's a weird question, because like, what happens if you suck and you're like constantly, you know, trying to play venues and you're playing shows, and like, if people aren't showing up, eventually, maybe it's not the right career for you. Maybe that's the worst thing ever to say. But you know, like, it's like the real world, right? You know, if nobody's buying your stuff, you know, then you know.
But one of the nice things about the platform is that you can kind of like narrow the scope of what you do. So you don't have to do everything anymore. Like if you're a producer who's like, you know, trying to put full beats together like I was, I'm good at a very small number of things, but I'm pretty good at those things. So on Outro, like you can really focus in on those things and like provide that as a service to someone. So like you can find whatever your niche is and like kind of fill that out. So as a drummer, you don't have to do like 20 different genres. Like if you're just good at like old school, like soul stuff, that's like laid back beats, then like that's what you can focus on. Hopefully you got something that you can kind of
And the way we've been working up until now is working with the creators and the people that we have on the platform. We've really been like, not hand curating, like we've just, you know, we've been talking to everybody and making sure that everybody's really great. And you know, there's so many talented people here too. So, you know, we have great ways of featuring people on the site. So whenever we work with a really great creator, you know, we can bump them up to the top page of the drummer's page and help them get even more exposure. And sometimes, like, we found this crazy talented producer, this random guy in Oregon, and I call him, and the guy's like 15. He's so young. He's like, "Man, I'm just on the way home from high school. I was just getting off the school bus." And I was like, "What? These tracks were nuts." So this guy has like no exposure. Nobody knows him. Like, no, his SoundCloud visibility is nothing, but one of our researchers found him. And like, we'd love to like help this guy do better and make awesome sales. So we're you know, featuring him on the front page of like the production of the producer's board. So we're trying to do our best internally just to highlight the right people and help people grow.
Is mixing a thing? Like, can I upload a bunch of raw waves and say I want to mix?
See, we're headed there. We're headed there. We thought about like how we can include like engineers in the platform as well.
And the problem initially is that it just gives us one too many things to focus on. We really want to like just zero in on like the exchange of content and how that can happen. But we've got like plans for you within like the next 6 months. We'll have like a multi-track like submission edit, like wave, workspace. So like you can, yeah, send stems back and forth. Mm-hmm. And I think it's like it's such a natural evolution of the platform is to like really close off the process. Right, yeah, and remixes and whatever, yeah. Yeah. All right, who's next?
Hey, thank y'all for coming.
Yeah, hey, man. Thanks for having us.
This is a good-ass idea. Are you guys hiring by any chance?
We actually need somebody to design our clothes.
Yeah, come talk to us after.
Yeah. Wait, so yes?
Always. Come talk to us.
Yeah.
Cool, next. This is a good question.
Yes. Are you guys ever going to start any sort of phone web app integration?
Definitely next step.
Because I was like just in this class trying to see if anybody had posted anything, and I realized that you can't get past the sign-up thing on the
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's going to be the first step, is like allowing you to kind of like check in on your projects and communicate with people and just push stuff forward so that when you get back home, like you're, you know, things aren't stagnant in that meantime.
Cool. Cool. Yeah, I just want to say thank you guys. First of all, that's incredible. Really, because I'm also a producer and I'm a creator of content. So to have some place to upload anything, even if I don't even like that good. All right, I made this thing. No, you know, like maybe one person over there is going to like it, but I'm not going to do anything with it. The other person gets it. So that's a great thing. I just had one question as far as like how it works when you're trying to be deliberate with who you work with. Say like you want to work out a songwriting contract with someone, you don't want to just send your stuff and then have them do whatever with. I think there's both sides. Like it can be great to have the freedom and just be like, cool, I'm going to give it away for free, I'm going to do this. But what if you're trying to, you know, is there like a contract involved? Like if you want to license something or you want to have, say, hey, if I'm going to give you this song, 30% of it is my songwriting. How does that all work?
That's a great, great question too, because that's another big step forward for us. It's still tough to see how we can make it happen, but obviously, right now everything is non-exclusive and royalty free. So when you buy something, literally anybody else could buy it, unless you're in a public or direct request scenario. At that point, it's literally just two people communicating and you work on something. But when you buy a piece of content, right now it's royalty free. So the next step is obviously license options for instrumentals or for content in general. And then a next step that we're trying to work on in Canada right now is how can we integrate songwriter splits and royalty assignment through the platform so you literally don't have to leave Outro. You work with somebody, they're sending you vocals, maybe even open up Skype on the side and you know, like you're actually working together and you say, you know what, let's split this song 50-50 and you're gonna go out and try and license this song or you have a publishing company or whatever. That's a big next step for us. Cool.
Good question.
Anybody else?
Yeah. Hi, I have two questions. My first is, do you think right now, I know your goal is probably try to get it to be equal, but do you think right now it's more a buyer's market or a seller's market in terms of, are a bunch of people posting things and no one's buying them, or are people looking for things and not able to find people?
Yeah, right now we're trying to build demand. So we've had no problem building the supply side of the platform. There's like thousands of creators on there ready to go. Whenever you have a two-sided marketplace, there's this whole like chicken and egg problem because both halves, they get value out of the other half, right? So if there's no drivers for Uber, then nobody's getting rides. If there's no apartments, nobody's got a place to stay. So it's the same for us. If there's nobody to make content, then nobody's gonna come to the platform because there's nothing to buy, there's nothing to interact with. But if there's no consumers, like the supply side kind of runs out of patience after a certain point. So that's what the Outro Million campaign is that Connor was talking about. That we're gonna blast like through all channels. We're putting a lot of money into just like getting exposure and like building the platform from a demand perspective so that we can bring that demand back and talk to like more groups of producers and creators and show them like the traction on the site and just use that to kind of like in a staggered way build both halves of the platform. It's really tricky to kind of do because we can't just like launch the software and then grow one person at a time. It really has to be calculated and it has to be sort of thought out. Yeah, but that's an awesome question. You said you had two?
Yeah. My next question is, Libby posted in like a Facebook group that I'm in that you guys are kind of lacking in like having female creators.
Yeah.
And I was wondering what you guys are doing to ensure a more diverse population of creators on your...
Yeah, I think you saw like an example. Libby's like really trying to increase the female population on Outro from the supply side. We're like trying to like tap into groups that exist and maybe you have some ideas. We'll talk to you afterward. Cool?
Cool.
Anybody else have any? Yeah, cool. Shoot.
I have a catalog full of bass loops and somebody buys one of the bass loops. When they buy it, do they get all of the rights or do I still have some of those rights?
So like we were saying before, right now everything is non-exclusive royalty free. So they have the right to use it. We have a terms and service agreement. They have the right to use it in any way they wish, except in redistribution and resale of that content. So they can't go out and resell your bass stuff, but they can use it wherever they want.
Can I use it Is it my own music, yes, or is it permanently like theirs?
No,
like,
you have full rights to your music. You can pull it off the platform at any point, and like you maintain that control over it.
Not unless I sell it, though. If I sell it, I can't just go and write a song using that loop that I just sold.
You still can, because it's a non-exclusive license.
Okay.
As a seller, let's say you make like 10 grand.
Sure.
How would you, I guess, how would taxes work? Would you get a 1099 from y'all? Or
yes,
how would we go about reporting the money you make off the website?
Exactly what you said.
Yeah, I don't know the specific forms in the States, but like in Canada, that's, we provide that to you. To all our top sellers, like come tax times, like you'll get all the documents you need. Yeah.
Yeah.
W9? Yeah, cool.
Awesome.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.